Okay, we have two more guests, right? And all our guests here today made quite an effort to be here, probably none more so than Dr. Arran Davis. I'm getting used to saying it now, Dr. Davis, yeah. This guy, he's my youngest brother, Thomas, is quite a bit younger than my oldest brother and myself. He's really good friends with Arran, best buddies, and they grew up together and shared a lot of experiences. But I got to know Arran quite a bit through the years, but I'll just share a little bit about him. In 2007, he graduated from here. He went to South Dakota State. He became a javelin thrower. I misspoke earlier. He learned to throw javelin in Argentina, right? He lived there for a semester before going to South Dakota State. But he'd never thrown javelin before in his life, and he just kind of picked it up later on in college. And in 2007, he became an all-conference javelin thrower at South Dakota State University, where my brother Thomas was playing quarterback at the time. And so Arran's like, hey, I'll come join you there, and we can kind of do this thing together. 2012, he was named NCAA D1 All-American Academic, which is quite an accomplishment. He then received a scholarship to study his PhD at Oxford University. Pretty amazing, right? I've heard a lot about this school. They probably would have never let me in, but he was able to go there on a scholarship where he also competed in javelin. He had 3 top 10 finishes at the British U Championship at British University. His research is really interesting, and I think one of the things we're trying to do here is build relationships and social structures that support you as people and as athletes, but a lot of his research has been around this, right? How do your interactions with your teammates influence the way you perform and your exercise? And we kind of have a couple doctors here from a psychological standpoint and a neuroscientist standpoint. They might battle it out a little bit. His research shows that positive, supportive, social, and team environments can enhance your performance, right? And so he has some interesting research that I'll share with you, but you've maybe been around like really positive people who it's really contagious, right? And these are important people to have on our teams, and so he'll speak to some of this. But before he did all that, I coached Arran when he was a little kid. Some of you have the Goodview Sandlot hat on, and he played out there in Goodview baseball. I had a chance to coach him and be a part of his life. But like I said earlier, he's impacted my life in a lot of positive ways, and I really appreciate him making the effort. He came from England to Boston to do some research with some colleagues, and then was able to come here. Now he's going to be flying back to Boston tomorrow and making his way back to England. So it was quite an effort for him to be here. But he also participated in 2006 and 7 on a team that I coached. He was a big part of the reason we went to the state tournament in 2006. He played a lot of third base for us and was a great hitter for us. And we were third place in the state that year. And then the next year we lost in the section finals and had his coach, me, maybe use him as a pitcher more. Maybe we would have even went to state tournament again. But please welcome to the stage Arran Davis.
Part of this process that I'm going to talk about, but it's not the most important thing. I think it's actually relationships. And so the process to me is like, it's about building a set of skills and habits and attitudes, the first thing, that allow you to be successful like in sports and also in life. And so the process, I think, Matt would say, is not really about wins and losses. It's not where you get the values and stuff, right? It's in the habits you learn how to build. And so that was really evident with Matt. He was never one to yell at us for like performing badly. And I had had bad performances, but Matt was always supportive and positive. And he taught me how to be an athlete person, which is really important. And I think that, you know, didn't mean it was easy to work with Matt. He demanded a lot of like about your attitude of practice, about how you approach the offseason, how you work in the offseason, and that to me was like the essence of what we call processes. How can you learn how to keep yourself better on a day-to-day basis and build the habits you need to improve every day? So there's lots of quotes out there about how you can do this. I like this one since it relates well to this idea of victory in the process. It's by this guy who won the Olympics, had a world record. He said that the purest form of motivation you can have is to say, I'm going to do this because it's going to make me a better person through the process of doing it. Do it as hard as I can because it's going to make me a better person. And that to me is where the victory comes in the process. It comes learning how to be positive with each other, with yourself, learning how to fail. And that's where you get the victory and get to be a better athlete and a better person. And so I graduated from Cotter. I knew I wanted to do sport after. I wasn't like a fantastic athlete at Cotter. You know, I wasn't getting like D1 offers or anything, but I did learn to throw javelin after graduating. And I was like, all right, I want to do the Division I level. And South Dakota State was the only school that would let me walk on. So there I went to South Dakota. I had a really interesting coach called Roger Haven. He was the U.S. Olympic champion, or sorry, marathon champion and U.S. Olympian. Really intense guy. He taught me a few things that I would like to share with you guys, but I think it's just useful to consider as you go about being a student athlete. First is that success is about habits. So he would always say, look, I'm not going to give you some motivational speech like in the movies, the day of the meet. But if I'm trying to motivate you on the day of the meet, I haven't done my job. Like, I need to motivate you in the months and the years before you start to compete, before the game, right? So he said, you win games, you win meets in the off-season, right? How you lift, how you train, what you eat, as Jeremy would say. And then this is actually the most difficult part of becoming a good athlete, is just like conquering that daily grind of doing the right habits. Because that's where the challenge comes. Second thing he said, I remember first day of practice, he's like, all right, being on this team is about building a relationship with pain, he called it, which I was scared to do that. But what he meant is that, you know, to train hard and to get better at something, you have to put your body into an uncomfortable position. You have to like sort of learn how to become comfortable with that. And he thought the best way to do that was like with your teammates. So he's always encouraging us to do these workouts with your teammates, like in the off season, encourage each other, compete with one another in a positive way. So you can still compete with each other, but in a way that you try to get better. And the last thing you were trying to do is like, you would just emphasize that, hey, it's a pretty ridiculous opportunity to be able to just go and do track for 20 hours a week, right? And for you guys, like it's if you look at the world and people's plights, like it's not something that everybody gets to do, is to try to improve themselves through sport. And so sometimes when you had to wake up at 6 a.m. for a workout, I just remember, hey, this is actually a pretty cool experience. And so it's something you guys can think about too, maybe when you're feeling a bit like practice with the slog. It's actually something you won't be able to do always, and it's something that a lot of people would literally dream to do and don't get the chance to. Last thing, and this one I still take to this day, is you would have a set ambitious goals for ourselves. And he said, you should set a goal that you're probably not going to reach. And so he said that, you know, when you set goals that are easy, it's just because you're kind of afraid to fail, right? And I remember when I was your age, failing was something I was definitely afraid of. I didn't want to admit that I was like trying hard and then failing at what I was trying to do, right? And that is actually just comes from a place of insecurity, I guess, and so something you can work on and overcoming. And you guys, you still know Michael Jordan, right? Sure. Yeah. So you've got to go up. Well, they were like barely born. Cool, right? So like all of my And you continue doing that, and you'll start building these things that eventually like. And so when I was at South Dakota State, I set a goal to reach Division I Nationals by my senior year, which was certainly ambitious. And Rod gave me some advice. He's like, you know, when you try to set a goal which is quite high, you might not really know how to get there, right? It seems so far away. And so what he said is the first thing you can definitely do is just find out what the people who have done the thing in the past do, and then just do that. And so he would give us the workout regimes of the past national champions and say, look, you're not going to be able to do this in terms of the weight, or the strength, not the strength, or the speed you have to do these workouts. You can put in the time and the effort. So that's where he had to start. And that's where I started. Did it for 4 years, 20 hours a week, grinding. I got better, became all conference, got a scholarship, athletically. But I didn't reach my goal in the end. I didn't actually get that close my senior year. I had an injury, and I was quite disappointed. But then I found out I had been named an Academic All-American, which is a good accomplishment for me, and only the second time a male had done it at SSU. And that sort of, I guess, kind of reminded me of the benefits of when you set a goal that you can't reach and you don't reach it. Actually, if you just try to do it, you might find that you're in a position where you wouldn't have thought you would have been if you never tried to do the different thing. Just set some other goal that was easy to maintain, right? Or easy to achieve. And so with that award, I was able to, also I don't study a lot. I forgot to mention that. And I kind of used some of the same things. Like I tried to appreciate that I was able to just study. I chose my major in college and study it. And I just went hard at it. Like I read the full textbooks and I did my citations and everything Oz has taught me. Read the syllabus. I said, dude, read the syllabus. Anyway, got me great. I was able to get to Oxford in the United Kingdom and do my PhD there. I study social relationships in sport at the broadest level. But what we're interested in is how positive and supportive social relationships, what we call social support in the psychology field, how that can affect how our body responds to exercise, how it can affect how we cooperate with one another, and view our social relationships, and how it can lead us to build these relationships that Matt's talking about, and how this can affect our sort of mental health and well-being. I'll start out with this study. I think it's pretty interesting. So these are some people, some collaborators of ours who actually have worked directly with Golden State, San Antonio, the NBA team. And what they looked at was a bunch of video from preseason and preseason games and practice, I guess. And they tried to record the amount of times that they were just positive with one another. So fist bumps, high fives, hugs, that sort of thing. And then they saw, okay, that was what they did in the preseason. How did that affect how they competed in the regular season? They found that these teams who were more positive with one another at practice and preseason, they actually were better at a better team. They helped each other more on defense, they passed more to their command, these sort of things that were making a bit. And that of course led to more wins. And so when you look at it again, this positivity is actually predicting how successful these teams were at the end of the year, such that the teams were had winning records were 50% more likely to do these sorts of positive behaviors at the beginning of the year. And so that, I think, is cool. I brought it, showed you guys today, because it's something you can do at practice, the next time you have practice, right? Every time you do a sport, you encounter a failure, just in little ways. A teammate miss a shot, whatever. You can respond to it with negativity, you can respond to it with positivity. It would suggest that these teams that are good learn how to respond to it with positivity. And you see that. I remember watching Golden State. They were down by 20 points, and the body language hardly changed. Because of professionals, they know how to be down, but that's a thing that they've worked on for many years, a mental fortitude that they've been able to build up, maintaining positivity in the face of the game. They came back to win the game, that's the point. So that's sort of about how how this can affect how we cooperate. There's also this idea that actually, as humans, we're social creatures, right? So we need positive relationships with our friends, with our family, to survive and to thrive. And these things are actually a really important part of our mental health and our physical health. And so one study that I always remember, I followed a bunch of people and asked them about their social relationships in their life, along with other health things. stress each day, right? So it really affects our body, how our social relationships, and you can imagine, right, when you're feeling lonely, it doesn't feel good, right? It changes the way your body is working. So we thought maybe there's a sort of similar thing in exercise. Maybe our social environments affect how we respond to exercise. And so one of the things that could matter is that it might change how we feel pain. And so if we're feeling supported and we're with our friends, it might make our body sort of interpret pain as a bit less uncomfortable. And so what we did is we worked with the Oxford University rowing team. And these are all very British sports, as Kyle said, but can't help that. Yes, we worked with them, and we had them either row individually or with their teammates. And we found that we gave them like a pain threshold test. And we found that when they did the workout with their teammates, same workout, they had a much higher pain threshold than when they were just on their own. So this is like, you know, if you're in your off season right now, do you go and just lift on your own, or do you keep your buddies there and do it together, right? And so we're saying, okay, that's interesting. Does it actually affect the way that they perform? So I think if you show this.
All our speakers, well, except for my brother, he's a
Scott, the part of the video that I cut out, when you said if you want to look him up on Instagram and ask him a question, he'd be happy to answer all these in person or personally. So anybody who's been here today, feel free to reach out to them. Again, that's a big part of what we're trying to do here in the community. All right. I just want to say a couple of things based on what Arran was saying and try to tie it back to some of the things that we're talking about. I love what he used. You used the word, like, you know, trying hard. And I know when I was in Shanghai, these kids sometimes say, oh, that person's a try-hard. Oh, they're always trying hard. They're a try-hard. And I would often ask them, like, what's wrong with that? What's wrong with trying hard at something? Right? I think sometimes it's a defense mechanism that we use to say, well, I'm not really trying that hard. That's why I'm not doing so well. Right? So it takes a little something to say, I'm trying hard at it. It didn't go that well. How am I going to come back the next time? Right? So I love that idea about working hard. And lastly here, just wrapping up, the process to me is a huge part of what we're asking you to do as athletes is the wins and losses, the scoreboard. We hire somebody to keep score of the game. They'll keep track of it. Your job is to think about what's the next right play to make, what's the next right move to make, process, process, process. And at the end, the score of the game is part of the evaluation, maybe about how we did, right? But it's just a piece of it. There's a lot of other things involved. All right. Thank you. I'm going to bring Mr. Costello up again.